He said, guy, who's, like, you never hear female.
Oh, shit, dude, we didn't hit record.
You can throw it up if you want, man. This is all going. In this episode, I turn Layne into a bro. Ask a Diet Coach show. We're back. I'm John Gorman, your host, joined today by Dr. Layne Norton. What's up, man?
What's up, John? Good to see you, man.
Yeah, so we're here in Tampa. We're at Layne's house. It's fucking 30 degrees in Missouri where I'm at, and I know you can sympathize because you're from, I mean, you grew up, you went to school in Illinois. Like, you don't miss those badass winters, I'm sure.
Oh, it's awful. Yeah. I much prefer down here.
Yeah, it's like 80 degrees right now. You've got the lake outside your house. I'm enjoying my week down here. So I got with Layne, as everyone is about to find out. Layne's got a new contest prep book coming out, and I got with him. I'm like, hey, listen, I want to be able to tell people about this book because no one else has released a contest prep book in its complete nature, everything all in one place, and you've done that now. So by the time that this recording airs, your book is going to be out. So I want to be able to tell people about where to get it. So just go ahead and give everyone an update, like what it entails and what we're looking at here. Yeah.
So you'll be able to get it at biolanestore.com. And also if you just go to my website, BioLane, we'll have the link there as well.
Yeah, I'm gonna throw that up on the screen for everybody.
Yeah, so basically, my friend Peter Baker, I've known him for 6-7 years. He's a fitness author. And he said, hey man, why have you never written a book? And at the time I was kind of in transition in my business life. And I was like, well, because I never really had the time or you know, it wasn't a priority. I'm like, well, can make it a priority now.
Yeah.
So, you know, from inception to launch, it'll be like right on 4 months that it took. So we really, like we went full in, you know. So it kind of took me a couple weeks to get started on it, you know, that writer's block. And yes. Then I just started pumping out 10, 20 pages a day, you know. And it is very complete. I mean, we start with, you know, part one, what do you need to know to be ready to start a prep, you know, from nutritionally training to mentality. And then it's, okay, how do we know where to start you diet wise? And we go into how to calculate everything, you know, right down to, how to calculate your maintenance calories from your tracking logs, you know? And then not just that, but I mean, we spend 25 pages just telling you how to calculate your calories, because it's not, we don't just tell people do this. We tell them, hey, this is why you're doing it this way.
Yep.
So it's not, here's a fish. It's, we're teaching you how to fish.
Right, and I've read the book because you gave me access to it. Mm-hmm. You're like, listen, I want you to read this, and I read the whole thing. And a lot of this stuff, you know, I worked with you back in the day in 2008.
Yep.
And this is all of your content that you put forth in the years after that. And it's all stuff that I learned. It's a lot of the stuff a lot of coaches I know learned, and it's all in one complete place. So going back when I read it, even though I quote unquote thought I knew a lot of it, I still picked up a ton of new stuff. So we have a lot of coaches and trainers that watch the show. And my message to you that follow what I do is, listen, you guys know I'm always telling you, you've always got to keep learning and being open-minded, but even if you think you're at the top of your game, you can read this book and still fucking learn. I learned like 3 or 4 things within the first half of the book. I'm like, fuck. I'm like, new shit. Like, I get excited.
I learned stuff writing it.
Right,
like,
yeah.
I had to dig deeper, because I will tell you that at every step, I mean, the book is 264 pages just on contest prep. And like I said, 25 pages just on calculating your calories, another 20 pages on how to calculate your macros, 20, 25 pages on refeeds and diet breaks, another 25 pages on peak week, you know. I think like 15 or 10 or 15 pages just on show day alone. So we really went into the details, but what's great is we go into the scientific details, but for the people who go, man, I don't have much of a science background, We lay it out in a way that's palatable,
yep.
But we also break it down into very simple, easy to understand tables to where you can just go, okay, I want to do this, boom, that's my number right there. Like, you don't have to have a degree in science to read this thing.
No, I like how you brought it down to all of our levels, like a normal level. And the other thing, too, is this is something where if you're a diet coach and a trainer, and you're working with people to get to the stage, this is going to make you, first of all, your clients are going to fucking look better because they're going to understand peak week. They're going to understand all the nuances and everything. But even if you're not prepping people and you're doing your first show or maybe it's your fifth show, you go into detail on everything from what to do to the day of the show, how to pack your shit and travel.
Like, yeah, we even talk about, like you said, talk about traveling, how to pick your hotel, what hotel you want. Because people don't think about this stuff, you know, but I think about everything, you know. It's a different sport, but even like down to powerlifting, when I was getting ready for IPF Worlds, I got there 5 days early and 2 days before the meet, because I don't go to the venue the day before the meet. I just sit in my hotel and I relax. I watch Game of Thrones or whatever.
Right, right.
And, but 2 days before the meet, I went to the meet and I said, okay, I stepped on the squat platform. I looked at where am I going to look? And then I went backstage, where's the weigh-in? Where's the bathrooms? Right down to like, okay, what platform am I going to warm up on? I wanted to visualize everything. I did the same thing at bodybuilding shows. The day before, or 2 days before, I'd go there. Where are the check-ins? Okay, what's the stage look like? What's the backstage area? Where's the pump-up room? I want to know. So when I get there, I'm not running around going, oh, where's this thing? Where's that thing? We go into all that, you know, right down to how to pack your food when you're traveling. Like, it may seem like little nitpicky stuff, but people don't realize every single thing I put in there because somebody at some point got crossed up on that.
Right.
You know, I had a guy who didn't pack his food correctly. It spoiled and he got there and, you know, he didn't have a backup plan, you know? So I talk about it, you know, I talk yeah. about traveling via the road, I talk about traveling via plane and like picking between those two, like it breaks down everything. Every single time I went, I wonder if I should put this in. I just said, fuck it, we're putting it in there.
Yeah. You know, and this is something we could do this whole fucking hour just talking about the book. We're going to answer some questions that yeah. you also answer in the book. We're going to answer some questions that are related to that. We're going to go into a little bit more detail. But I want to tell you guys, buy this fucking book. I promise you, buy it. Hold on to it. It's going to be very relevant for a long time. Yeah. It's going to make you either a better coach or it's going to make you a better bodybuilder. Because the thing is, you've been doing this longer than 99% of the coaches out there right now. A lot longer than me. I mean, you're doing this 10 years before I have, and I'm fucking old, and I've been doing it for a while. So Layne's been there. He's done that.
Before online coaching was a thing.
Well, it was a thing because you had to tell motherfuckers it was a thing and convince them to do it. So guys like me could now become yeah. fucking online coaches. So Layne's track record and his experience with clients, like he's done all of this stuff in the trenches. Now it's in a book. So guys, go buy the book. With that being said, let me explain our show to you real quick. We have a lot of coaches and trainers that watch the show or people that are just very interested in physique enhancement. So a lot of people interested in bodybuilding. We don't get a lot of gen pop questions and stuff like that for general fat loss. So this is very detailed and that's why you're the perfect guest for the show and it's related to bodybuilding. So if you ever want to send your questions, send them to john@team-gorman.net. I'm going to throw that up right here on the screen. Or my Instagram is @team_gorman. If I don't get them answered on the show, usually I reply back and I get you an answer either way. So go ahead and send your questions in and we'll save them. We have some of the top diet coaches, researchers on the planet on the show, or sometimes it's myself and Leslie. We just recorded with Paul Rivella not too long ago because I'm down here in Florida. So a lot of great, great guests on the show. Let's go ahead and get to the first question. So how fast should someone go back to maintenance? Notice I said maintenance. How fast should someone go back to maintenance after a show? That was sent in from John Helms through email. So let me preface this for you. I'm just going to throw you batting practice real quick. Let's explain what maintenance is, because there's a lot of people out there and they don't do what we do. And they're saying you should just rapidly go back to maintenance. And to them, maintenance is their fucking off-season calories from like 5 months ago.
Yeah.
And I know you break this down in the book because I read it, but I want you to explain to them what going back to maintenance faster, slower should be.
Yeah, so I mean, if we're talking about like your actual maintenance of what, you know, because people think they're debating with me and they're actually not when they talk about reverse dieting. So what I want to say is, well, if it was your maintenance, by definition, you're not going to gain weight then.
Right.
But like you said, what people think is their off-season maintenance. I'm talking about your actual maintenance, right? Which actually is going to be pretty damn restrictive when you're finished.
It's low.
Now, do you have to do it that way? No, you can certainly go back up to your off-season maintenance if you're okay with accommodating more body fat gain. Now, your testosterone will come back up faster. You'll feel more normal faster. But you're going to put on quite a bit of body fat. And as long as you're okay with that, then that's fine.
Most people aren't fucking okay with that.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, you have to... It needs to be a conscious decision. If you're going to say, well, I'm going to go back to my off-season maintenance, so I'll be fine. No, you're going to put on 15, 20 pounds. Like, that's what's going to happen. Because your off-season maintenance is here and your actual maintenance is here. Like, look at the study by Chris Foss that I referenced in the book.
Yeah.
They tracked him through a contest prep. His BMR when he started was about 2,400 calories per day. When he finished, it was 1,285. 1,285. Yeah, and we're talking about, have you seen Chris?
Yeah.
He's a big guy. Yeah. He's not a small guy. You know, we're talking about some bikini competitor, right? So, you know, if he went back up to his off-season maintenance, and that's just BMR, right? Like, not even accounting for activity factor, he would have gotten put back on very, very quickly, you know?
Yeah,
so
it would have doubled his
maintenance. I think that it's you know, there's not a right or wrong way to do things necessarily. It just depends on what your goals are and being honest with yourself. Okay, if you want to ramp your calories back up faster, fine, I have no problem with that, but you're gonna put on body fat, you know? Like, what I'm saying, and most competitors tell me, the criticism I've got with reverse dieting, I think is pretty unfounded, to be honest with you, because most competitors are telling me, hey, I want to maintain a little more of this leanness. Okay, well, but you're gonna have to be more restrictive. So you can't get something for nothing.
Yeah, you're gonna have to increase slower, but what I want people to understand is, off-season maintenance and maintenance after someone comes off a diet for a show. So like if a guy comes off a diet and he's, you know, he's dieting on 1800 calories and he gets stage ready. Are we going to have to, we're being interrupted here. So since you're interrupting the show, you're just going to have to come make a cameo real quick.
Oh no, John called you out.
You're just going to have to come say hi to everybody.
Really?
And then we'll finish.
Can I say hi
later? The clock's ticking here, so.
She's shy.
I'm cringing right now.
It's okay. You can just jump in here, wave to everybody. We're talking about off-season maintenance.
Oh, this is your rule. I was talking about maintenance calories after a show. Actual maintenance versus predicted maintenance.
Oh, okay. All right. Do you want me to contribute to this?
Yeah. What would you say? So I was just talking about how most people, what they think maintenance is their off-season maintenance. But
after a show.
Yeah.
There's no chance that it's going to be the same. You're going to adapt crazy amounts, depending on how long your dieting period is, I guess, but yeah, it ain't gonna be the same.
All right, well, she just made us both look better. Thanks, babe.
Great. High five.
Awesome. So yeah, that's what we want people to understand. If you're a guy and you just come off the diet and you're on 1800 calories and you're stage ready, you're not going to be able to go up to 3500 calories fast. If you do, you'll accumulate fat. So my point is your maintenance.
You'll have to grease the doorways to get you through.
Right. So maybe your maintenance after that is, you know, if you were 1800, it might be 2300.
Right.
Or somewhere in that range. There's no way for me to tell. So
yeah, I will tell people. I think there's actually, and you might, I'll take your input on this. I think there's actually not a set maintenance point. I think maintenance is actually a range. I think there's a lower end and an upper end of about a 200 to 300 calorie range that you can sit in, and if you go to the end of it, you don't change weight, and if you go to the top of it, you don't change weight.
Yeah.
You just kind of, it's a buffering range.
Man, I've seen that with a lot of clients, and there's that, I call it the fucking unicorn range. Like, you get that range where you take someone to right after a show, and literally, I found this out by reverse dieting people into multiple shows.
That is always the way reverse dieting works best.
Yes, it's
when people are still hyper-focused,
yes,
tracking everything that goes into their mouth, and they start adding calories when they're already really lean, usually they get leaner.
Yeah.
It's pretty wild to watch.
Yeah. So I kind of figured that out by accident.
Yeah.
You know, taking people from show to show, and they actually got leaner because I took them back faster.
Yeah.
But then I've also seen females that have shit metabolisms because they've dieted for 5 years in a row.
Yeah.
Where I just add, you know, if I add 30 carbs in a week because they want to gain faster, they're gaining like that.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, it's tough all the way around.
I have a gal right now. She was so bad. I took her she was at 110 grams of carbs a day and, like, 35 grams of fat. Just taking her to 190 and 50 grams of fat, she's put on 20 pounds.
Oh, wow.
Like, and, I mean, I don't doubt this gal's intake. Like, she is tracking meticulously. She's showing me her diet, everything she's eating. some people, like, man, it just, that, those years and years of beating yourself down, so.
That's why I think dieting is an art form. You've said that before. You have to really take every single person into account. So that, great question from John Helms. You know, we want to explain the difference. All right, the next question comes from Kenny Osborne, sent in through my Facebook. Kenny wants to know, with all the new research coming out showing branched-chain amino acids are literally not needed at all, can you please explain...
Objection, leading the witness.
Exactly. Can you please explain your stance on where you stand? So I've been saving this question for a long time because you've been involved with a lot of research with branched-chain amino acids. You're an expert in protein and leucine. There's been research that's came out that says basically if your protein's high enough, there's really no need to take branched chain amino acids. Now, the way he structured the question, he's not in the industry. He doesn't get it. But I want you to explain the difference, or just go ahead and explain to people if there's a benefit for BCAAs and when there's not. And then I have a couple questions from you that I have as well.
Yeah, so they're not needed. But need versus what is maybe helpful or optimal is a different question. That's right. Why people say, well, you don't need carbs. No, you don't. Doesn't mean they're not helpful.
Right.
Okay. Now, what I will say is I'm pretty convinced that supplemental BCAAs are not a muscle builder. I don't think you're going to build more muscle on them compared to a higher protein diet.
Right.
What I think they are is a recovery agent. There's good evidence to show they decrease muscle protein degradation, and they decrease delayed onset muscle soreness. So, in a roundabout way, they can be helpful in terms of improving your recovery from session to session, allowing you to train harder, and hopefully by supporting your training that way, they can help you build more muscle.
Right.
But direct muscle building, no. Support for training, yes. And I think that's still a useful benefit, depending on where that ranks in your hierarchy, hard to say.
So someone that's not going to be on a higher protein diet, because there are plenty of situations where protein can't be high, such as a ketogenic diet, it needs to be low.
Vegans.
Or someone that just has digestive issues that maybe doesn't want to eat that much protein.
Yeah, in that case, I mean, you know, we showed in our study, like, we took a really low-quality protein diet, also a low-protein diet, supplemented with leucine to match the leucine content of, like, a higher protein diet, and we showed the same effects.
Right.
Right? So, yeah, if you're someone who has to be on a lower protein diet for whatever reason, yeah, and actually leucine is completely ketogenic. So I believe isoleucine is ketogenic and gluconeogenic, and valine is gluconeogenic. So if you're on a ketogenic diet, if you took all three BCAAs, you're probably fine because it's not, you don't have to take that much. Like a small dose is pretty anabolic.
Right.
But if you just took leucine, like now it's completely ketogenic, you're probably actually... going to stay in ketogenesis and maybe give yourself a little bit more anabolism.
Gotcha. A question that I get a lot from people is if I have, you know, a whey protein shake before I train, you know, within an hour before I train, and then I have a whey protein shake post-workout, and I'm getting 25 grams of protein or more, do I necessarily need to have branched-chain amino acids while I'm training?
No, you don't need to. Now, you know, there's some evidence that, okay, maybe you can jumpstart recovery, maybe it can help you train harder. I think it'd be pretty minimal effect. But yeah, I think people tend to overestimate. You know, I call it the Tebow effect. So, you know, like Tim Tebow, everybody loves Tim Tebow or hates Tim Tebow.
Right, right.
And nobody's in the middle, everybody comes like this.
Right.
That's what we do in the fitness industry, right?
Right, exactly. So, especially bodybuilding.
So back in the day, it's like, I take no frequency. No frequency is the most important thing. Now it's, it doesn't matter at all.
Right. Extremes, both sides.
Nutrient timing. It's the most important thing. Doesn't matter at all. Truth is usually in the middle,
right?
So
with almost everything. Honestly.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So keep in mind with studies, you know, like even some of the stuff, it's pretty hard to pick out physiological differences. Like, especially when you're talking about a heterogeneous population, different genetics, and they've only got 8-10 subjects in a group, I'd say the default is you're usually not going to pick out differences just because the standard error is so high.
Right.
You really need big studies, and people say, why didn't they do this? Why didn't they do that? Because they put up damn money.
Right.
Like, very few people want to pay for studies on bodybuilders, you know? So, and by the way, bodybuilders suck as test subjects. I talked about this in the physique summit. But yeah, it's, you know, so that's why, you know, a lot of this is going to be theoretical. And, you know, I'm never going to say that you need supplements.
Right.
You don't need supplements. But, you know, I think saying that something is completely worthless when there's it's kind of ambiguous data. I think that's going too far. I would never go so far as to say, oh, BCAAs are super important. You're not going to grow muscle without them. You know, you need them. Like, you know, I had a supplement company for a while and I probably went under because I didn't say stuff like that. You know, I just, I was honest. Like, yeah, this stuff might help you train a little bit harder, but, you know, it's probably not going to make you put on 20 pounds of a slab of beef.
Yeah. And then the other thing that I want to point out, we brought up vegans earlier. You actually were involved with a study, if I remember. I remember hearing probably 4 or 5 years ago about this, where you took, I think it was pea protein, soy protein, egg protein, and whey protein, and you added leucine to like soy and egg and wheat, and you were able to get the, you know, the anabolic effects and boost protein synthesis the same.
It was interesting. So we actually, we had a wheat, soy, egg, and whey group, and I don't really go into disparaging anybody at the Journal of Nutrition, but they initially accepted it and then rejected it later after we'd gone through all the revisions, which, by the way, never happens.
Right.
Ironically, the some people who were probably reviewers on the paper published something similar a few months later. How funny how that happens. But they said, oh, well, you haven't really shown that leucine is the mechanism. Like, that they're, you know, even though it just happened to fit perfectly with the leucine levels.
Right.
So what we did was we went back to show that, okay, we supplemented, we took wheat, which is the lowest leucine protein, supplemented with leucine to match the leucine content of whey, the highest level of leucine protein, and showed that the anabolic response was completely identical.
Right.
Like almost down to the percent, you know. And so we're like, okay, well there it is. You know, pretty convincing in my opinion. So yeah, like if you're a vegan and you don't want to use any animal protein whatsoever, supplementing with leucine could be a, you know, and it's usually made from, it's either made from yeast or hair. Now, before you all go out there, let me go on a little side rant.
Oh,
all you people, there's so many companies saying, well, our BCAAs are made from yeast and not human hair and duck feather. Who gives a shit? They distill it down to where it's like you, it's not like you're eating hair.
Right.
It's the same amino acids. Like,
yeah.
So anyway, that's a little side rant.
No one watching is going to give a shit. Like, they're going to be like, well, I just learned something new. So.
Yeah, like, they're the same thing.
Right.
It's just how it got there, right? Like, there's a lot of chemical reactions and stuff. You're not, the purification process is very advanced. You're not actually eating hair. So, but, yeah, so for people like that, like, those are vegan sources. You could be, you know, you could maintain your vegan, you know, if you're doing it for ethical issues, you can be assured that, you know, animals aren't being harmed, and still, you know, especially if you're getting it from yeast, be sure that animals aren't being harmed and you're still able to get a little more anabolic effect.
And then one other example that I, because someone's tracking all their macros, I'll use a female for example, and she's having 20 grams of protein per meal, 120 grams a day. She's having 20 grams of protein per meal, and she eats oatmeal with that meal, and she's counting the protein in that. Now maybe she's down to 15 total grams of protein for whatever protein source she's going to use. Maybe it's eggs. That's still not going to be a lot of a leucine content. So I've always told my clients, I'm like, listen, if you want to add BCAAs there and slam them, or add straight leucine there, it's going to help boost
protein synthesis at that meal. Sure, what I would say is, you know, maybe actually do a few less meals and bigger meals.
Right,
you
know? That's the other thing I tell. Maybe you should take 120 and break
based
it into
on,
four
based
meals.
On some regressions and some meta-analysis, what we, you know, Alan Aragon, I think, and Eric Helms wrote a paper on this, and it kind of jives with what I've been saying, which I thought 4 to 5 meals a day, something like that.
Yeah.
If you did three, you're probably not doing a bad disservice. If you did six, you're probably not doing a bad disservice.
Right.
But the sweet spot seems to be about 4 to 5 protein-containing meals per day.
Yeah, so you'd rather see someone eating 120, break those down into 4 meals of 30 to get more leucine per meal.
Because you're making sure you're triggering the response that way.
And I like to ask clients to do that. And the only time I have kickback is if they're usually very obsessed with eating more often.
Yeah.
And you know how bodybuilders, like when people first start, they're obsessed. Like, I want to eat eight meals in a row, or like
talking about
spread out.
Fucking terrible lifestyle. Like,
and we all went through it.
Yeah,
so
it's
all
like, of us. But it's like, I remember when I couldn't leave the house, I'd have a protein bar, a Tupperware container.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
Cooler bag.
So there's pretty much everything that you want to know about branched chain amino acids in regards to that.
Take question. It for what it's worth.
Yeah. Okay, next question comes from Jalen Storm, sent in through email. Jalen says, I'm in my prep and starting to run really low on carbs. Are there certain meals you would make sure to have carbs at no matter what, such as pre, intra, and post-workout? I have some people, I've seen some people pulling post-workout carbs to help with fat burning. So basically she's wanting to know, where would you leave your carbs? Do you believe in pulling them from post-workout to help maximize fat burning? Where do you stand
on
that?
So the idea being, okay, you just trained. Now if you don't eat carbs, you're going to burn more fat. People forget that diet happens over 24 hours, right?
Right.
So by that logic, why ever eat carbohydrate?
Right.
This is like the people that are like, don't eat carbs in the morning because it stops fat burning. No shit. Whenever you eat carbs, it will block fat burning. So by that logic, why ever eat carbs?
Right.
The reason being, okay, well, you're on a 24-hour period. So if you eat those carbs post-workout, let's say you had 40% of your carbohydrate post-workout, 40% pre-workout, just for argument's sake. Yes, you are blocking fat burning at those times. It also means you're consuming way less carbohydrate throughout the rest of the day, and the rest of the day you're burning more fat.
Right.
Your body's very smart, you know. If you, again, the metabolic flexibility thing. Well, if you eat carbs in the morning, you blunt fat burning throughout the day. Yeah. You also burn more fat at night.
Right.
And the net effect being zero.
Right.
No difference. They've never been able to show a difference. So I would say, why not have those carbohydrates pre and post workout when you need them to perform? Well, you don't need them, but when they can help with your performance and they can help with your recovery afterwards. So that's the way I feel about it. Now, am I going to yell at you if you say, well, you know what? Like, we're all making exceptions. People say, well, I train early in the morning, and if I have that many carbohydrates pre and post workout, I'm so hungry later in the day. Okay, well, cool. Then don't have so many, right? Because overall adherence is the number one thing. You know, and I found it to be true. Like, I like to have more of my carbohydrates at night. So if I'm contest prepping and I train in the morning, I wake up and I feel okay. And I can run on a little bit less food. So I'll go do it that way. Probably because, you know, when you eat more at night, it's not like that glycogen like just magically gets up and disappears to the middle of the night.
Right.
You still have that, so.
Yeah, I like to recommend for those of you that have sent this in to me multiple times and I've been sitting on this question. You know, I'm a big believer in insulin sensitivity as well. Like, if you're in the off season, I know this is a dieting thing, but if you're in the off season, your body's going to utilize carbohydrates best around your workout. But it's still, to me, it's one of those things that kind of comes out in the wash. It's kind of, you know, if you don't eat them here and you eat them there, it's splitting hairs.
Yeah, I mean, again, keep in mind the 24-hour nature of things, right? If you eat, it's like one meal versus eight meals, right? People go, oh, well, no, if you eat, you know, there's on both sides, right? If you eat eight small meals, you're not very storing very much fat each meal. No, but you're also spending way less time post-absorptive.
Right.
So you're also not burning as much. Where if you eat one huge meal, yeah, you store a lot of fat after that. And then for the other 16 hours, you're just doing nothing but burning it,
right?
So the net effect, again, being zero based upon the data we have.
Right. Pretty much comes out in the wash.
Okay. Do what you can stick to.
Yeah, exactly. Adherence is the number one thing. All right, Lyle Walls sent this in through email. Lyle wants to know, is there a rate of fat loss when dieting for a bodybuilding competition that is best for muscle retention? And I know you definitely covered this in the book.
Definitely covered this in the book. Yeah, so, again, these are case studies, so it's hard to say, you know, but it looked like once you get about 1% of body weight loss per week, there's kind of an inflection point where you start losing a lot more lean body mass.
Right.
So it's about, it becomes, you know, up to like 0.6, 0.8 per week. It's about 30% what you can expect to lose of lean body mass, of the amount of weight you lose from lean body mass. Now people freak out and they go, oh my God, what a terrible diet. Well, keep in mind, lean body mass is water, intestinal mass,
right,
liver, bone, hair, all these other non-fat tissues, like literally every other non-fat tissue. You know, what you actually lose from actual, you know, wet muscle tissue, probably a third or less than that. You know what I mean? So, again, it's not as bad as it sounds. But when you're talking about, so if you're talking about 30%, we want to minimize as much as possible. 30% seems to be the standard. If we can do better than that, great. But if we get up around 1%, it switches to almost 50-50. You're losing from lean body mass and fat mass.
Right. So, and the leaner someone gets, like towards the tail end of prep,
yeah,
cardio's high, like most people, yeah, steady state cardio is high.
If you start fat off, you're gonna, a lot of times you have to sacrifice some muscle. It's a balancing act, you know? Yeah. Especially with females who have trouble getting their legs lean, like it's kind of like, all right, how much do we want to suck you down up top to be able to get those legs lean enough?
Yeah.
And that's a balancing act. That's where coaching is kind of an art form and not necessarily a science. But yeah, I think that there's a time and place for things. I mean, you could even, like, if you're doing something like diet breaks, you could go for a rate of loss of 1% during the diet weeks, but then during the diet break weeks, you're doing maintenance. So overall, your rate of loss is less, right? So there's a number of ways to do it.
So let's break it down then, like an average, what most people watching can, what I try and do is I try and aim for a pound of scale weight, because that's what I'm measuring, a week. So if someone has 20 pounds to lose, maybe they diet for 20, 25 weeks. Mm-hmm. Instead of, I used to diet people for 12 weeks, and it's like 2 pounds a week. And then if you get behind, it's really fucking
12
bad.
Weeks is, you better be lean already.
Right.
You know?
And a lot of people don't get that. So I elect for like a longer prep with smaller amount of weight lost. And then, you know, being able to be ready early. But I've noticed a lot of things like dieting certain people from year to year. When I used to diet people for 12 weeks hard, and I would turn around dieting for 20 to 25, their fucking stage weight was up. And they didn't put a bunch of muscle on in the offseason. Yeah, they're natural competitors. They retain more, which I made a huge post about on Facebook today. Yeah. You guys can go back and look at that. It was done in February. But it was a lot of little things like that. And the rate of loss was lower instead of trying to lose 2-3 pounds a fucking week.
Yeah, I mean, you give time for life. I talk about this in the book. I'm like, you're going to have some shit go down during your prep. Like, that's probably going to happen. Like, it's not going to be, people are like, oh, let me get my life all carved out. So your life's never going to be perfect. Like, I've had people who have had every tragedy you can imagine happen to them during prep, from everything, pet dying, family member dying, like, God forbid, like, a kid getting sick, you know, like, everything. So, you know, and there are some times where it's, you know, you have to pull the plug because of, you know, something's more important. But if you don't want to pull the plug, you better give yourself time, you know, because there's going to be shit that comes up and you want to be able to accommodate it.
All right. So here's the thing. All
right. Oh, I didn't address the rate. So I'd say, what I say in the book is about 0.4 to 0.8% of your body weight per week is what I recommend.
Yeah. That's so just do the math on that, and you'll be able to see that, you know, smaller is definitely better. And there's research to support that as well. You know,
smaller's not always better, but in this case.
Well, here we go. Speaking of, we're about to go there. So we have some rapid fire questions, and I want to let you know, you're just now seeing these for the first time. You've got them pulled up on your screen over there. I want you to be able to embrace possibly being a bro.
Okay.
All right? For a minute. I'm half bro. People know that. I don't give a fuck. Like, I'm proud of it.
Never go full.
But I want you to be able to answer some of these without being scared of saying, listen, there's no research to support that. Literally, it's a theory. I want you to be able to say, listen, there's no research, but this, if, basically, I'm going to inject you with true serum right now, and you would have to answer these. Like if Wonder Woman had her lasso around you. So
it's hard for me not to, but I'll try to be straight.
And these are rapid fire, so I'll nudge you if you're fucking going down the rabbit hole. So I'm used to working with Sal Fisella on the TNT podcast. Yeah. So like I'm used to keeping people on track. Did I hear Holly laughing back there? Is she back there laughing? Nope. She's back. There it is. You guys hear that? All right. So here's the first rapid fire question. All right. If you had to pick one over the other for achieving the leanest, most muscular physique, what would be better, HIIT cardio or steady state cardio?
Whatever you prefer. It's probably a wash.
But if you had to pick one,
me personally had to pick one, probably at this point, steady state. Just to be honest, the only reason being,
I'm just fucking around.
The only reason people are going to be shocked because I used to be a big proponent of HIIT, which I still think HIIT has some great merits to it. But I'm so busy, I can listen to a podcast while I'm in steady state. I can read a book. I can write something. Like I can do some other thing while I'm doing it, right? As opposed to HIIT, which I got to get mentally prepared for, mentally jacked up for. And then it's going to be, like, while I'm doing it, I'm not able to do shit. And then afterwards, I'm not really able to do shit because I'm so wiped out, right? So, yeah.
So
people are shocked by that answer. People are going to be like, well, oh my God, Layne's fucking hypocrite.
No, it's okay, because what I did is I told you I wanted you to embrace your inner bro. So now you're walking on a treadmill incline for an hour straight. Like, that's your bro. I get what you're doing, but let me rephrase it.
The only time you can really make fun of me is if I decide to put like a sweat hoodie on.
Oh God.
And then like, you know, put like really dark black, make the video in dark black and white. Like,
but it works really, for the big guys, man.
It's really like, this is very serious and my life is very hard.
It's what the big guys do though. Yeah. Like the steady state. So let me rephrase the question.
If you didn't put the hoodie on.
If let me rephrase it. And if you still stick with steady state, that's cool. So if you wanted to achieve the leanest, most muscular physique, what would you elect? HIIT or steady state cardio?
I don't think there's a difference between the two.
Got it.
I think it's whatever you prefer.
Who's more of a diva, Layne Norton or Kim Kardashian?
Well, I don't know Kim personally, but I think she probably is. I'm not gonna mince words. I mean, but I think I'm a pretty confident guy, but I wouldn't say that I'm difficult to work with. I don't know. What do you think, man?
Holly votes Layne. So what you guys can vote.
Am I difficult to work with?
I didn't work. I worked with you back in 2008. So that
I meant like when setting things up, like the physique summit, that kind of stuff. I feel like I was pretty much just.
Oh, I mean, here the question isn't for me. The question is for you to answer. You?
I don't think I'm.
All right, he votes for Kim.
But I
want
you
guys to vote.
I don't know Kim.
Vote on Facebook if you're watching this on Facebook, and I'm going to pick a winner and send you something cool, whether it's a book, a Fat Muscle shirt. Maybe a couple cans of Monster. You guys vote and we'll see. Kim or Layne? Yep, definitely. All right, so the next question is, all right, remember, you've got True Serum in here. What would cause more muscle growth over time in the chest? If you did a plate-loaded chest press by itself, or if you did that same plate-loaded chest press with bands?
This is such
same
a
hard, volume,
such
same
a hard, well, the thing is, it's hard to equate the volume, because the weight is changing throughout the movement. So that is why it's so hard to know what the study, because
but
right
bros
now,
don't fucking count volume. I just want you right. just to be like, ah. Not used to this, are you? Not used to fucking having
no,
to
I just don't know the answer to that. I guess maybe with bands, light bands, because here's the reason why. You could probably use the same straight weight because you tend to be most people tend to be stronger at lockout than they are off the chest.
Right.
So if you had something that did not impede you off the chest, and then you're overloading the lockout, maybe you could get a little bit better from there. But then, I mean, the pushback would be, all right, well, it's going to be harder at lockout, so your subsequent reps are going to be harder. You won't do as many reps, where you could do more reps with straight weight. I think if there's a difference, it's going to be very small. Very small, but I might go in favor of the bands.
So you heard it here first. Layne said, go add bands to your training if you want to build a bigger chest.
Bands are the great. You can't build muscle without bands.
Yep.
It's the greatest thing in history, and straight weight sucks.
Yep. Yeah,
that's how Twitter will interpret that.
You can quote him there. Who is the best natural bodybuilder of all time?
Well, I like statistics, so I would say Dave Gooden, just because he won more money than anybody else, and he's a fucking awesome guy and a savage. If you're going to say who's the greatest natural physique of all time, and I know there's going to be people say, oh, he's not natty. I'm going by people who have never failed a drug test and have competed in natural bodybuilding.
Yeah, I don't care about
it. Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, it's hard to argue against Doug Miller. I mean, it really is. Like, I'm a big Philip Ricardo Jr. fan, but, like, in terms, just because Phil gets so fucking lean, you know. But you look at Doug Miller's physique, it's hard to make an argument for somebody else.
Yeah.
I mean, he is about as freaky as they come. I mean, he's standing next to IFBB pros, and if he's shredded, he's not going to look out of place, you know?
If Doug shows up and I've got my best clients there, I'm sweating. I mean, I'm just going to be honest. I can't think of anyone that can beat Doug right now, unless there's someone out there we just don't know about.
I mean, you know, there's like guys like, you know, Martin Daniels and those kind of things, but nobody has that combination. I mean, the one thing you could knock Doug for is his quads don't get quite as shredded as everything else, but
last time he was on though.
Yeah, but I mean, that's the thing. He's one of those guys. He doesn't have many weaknesses.
Yeah.
I mean, he doesn't have many weaknesses.
I think there are guys that can stand with him, but they just don't seem to get to the condition.
But if he's in that kind of conditioning, good luck.
Yep.
And I love Dave Gooden, but Dave on his best day wouldn't beat Doug on his best day.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, it's hard to beat size. Fuck. I mean, we could go on about that forever.
And then buys. I got pretty good arms, but not next to Doug Miller.
No. Who's the smartest pro bodybuilder out there? And it doesn't matter.
There's actually a lot of them.
Well, you know what? Let's name two.
But, I mean, Brian Whitaker is very intelligent.
That was my pick.
Very, 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 very intelligent. You know, just
not a better guy on the planet.
No.
Way.
Brian is a great human. You know, like, I kind of... It's just people you can talk with, who you can have a good discussion. Flex Lewis is a very smart guy. Mm-hmm. You know, really enjoy talking with him.
If they were all in one room and you had to pick the smartest guy in the room, who would you pick right
probably,
now?
Probably Brian Whitaker.
Yeah, I agree.
He's a female.
Female? She's standing right there. I'm not just saying.
She hit you with a whip all the way across the room. So.
Listen. Yes, like, I probably would say that regardless, but I can actually say it honestly. Holly is like one of the most intelligent females I've ever been around. Like, and not just qualified as a female. She's just a very intelligent person. And, I've never been around somebody consistently that's that smart. It's good. It actually challenges me.
Dude, you're buttering it up. You guys are getting ready to go on a date, so I know we've got to shut this down and get out of here. Listen, bros know how to do it. So, tell everyone real quick how they can contact you, the best place to contact you, and more importantly, let's talk about the book one more time. Where can they purchase the book?
Yeah, so the book's going to be available at biolanestore.com. You can find me on biolane.com, which will also have a purchase link for the book on biolane.com. And then my social media is pretty much all BioLane.
Yep.
You know? So I'm
throwing it all up here on the screen.
At BioLane, Twitter, at BioLane. You know, Twitter seems to be falling off, but I feel like that's actually my best social media platform because I respond to a lot of stuff on there. And I like it. You have to be pretty intelligent to banter in 140 characters, or now 280. Yeah, yeah.
It's not like the message board days back in the day when you and I were arguing over shit.
Yeah, exactly. Me and John had some epic battles back in the day.
Hey, but, I learned a lot from that.
It'll come around from the end.
No, here we go. And now who's on my show?
Yeah. Hey, I'm happy to be on. You know, I
appreciate it, man.
I love seeing people that, like, either I've worked with in the past or known, or I just know to be good people. You know, like, I'm happy to see people out there succeeding who have, you know, kind of, you know, gone out for their own. You know, it's out there. It's a big industry. You know, and it's not. You know, people, I made a post about this the other day, but people make this thing like there's a bunch of scarcity, and it's really not. Like, we have, like, unlimited potential for earning in this industry, because who doesn't want to look better? Who doesn't want to feel better? Like, it's unlimited. So, you know, when you look at it like that, I'm happy to support other people who are doing good stuff, putting good information out.
Yeah, no, I appreciate you being on the show. I've had a lot of people email in and say, you know, hey, get Layne on the show. I knew you had the book coming out. I had time to read it, and I read it pretty quick. I made the time to read it in about a week. And I thought, you know what, man, we've got to tell people about this. So, guys, buy the book. For myself, Holly in the background, and Layne, we're out of here. Thanks, guys.